starts in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Good afternoon, Ava here. I would like to welcome everyone to the iBUG Apple Workshop, episode number 131, for Saturday, August 20th, 2022. Thank you to those joining us this afternoon, and to those of you listening to the recorded playback. More and more of the blind community are finding the Apple devices to be useful assistive technology tools in their daily lives. Whether at home, at work or school, or on the go, the accessibility features of the Apple devices have cleared new pathways for the blind to be more productive, consume online content, and stay connected through social media. This meeting is being recorded. To enhance the quality of the recording, please minimize background noise and side conversations. Also, please set your devices to mute and use your headphones to not disturb others. If we hear any phone ringtones, dogs barking or screen readers speaking aloud, we may, unfortunately, have to remove you from the meeting. We ask that everyone stay on mute, unless, of course, you have a question or comment. We have an exciting meeting planned for today. We will first review some iBUG announcements and some recent Apple news and rumors. Then, Tyler Merren will present the Revision Fitness app and David Cleveland will demo how to download iBUG podcasts using the Apple Podcast app. Finally, we will spend any remaining time to answer general questions you may have. I would now like to turn the meeting over to the iBUG guy, Michael McCulloch. Ready to go, Michael?
Yes, yes, yes! We are ready to go! Let's go, let's go! I'm Michael, I'm going to be your host for this meeting today. And with me, Sandhya Rao, our beautiful co-host, will be helping out. And we are ready to get this thing going. Hope everybody's staying cool in this hot summer months. We're about to cool things down. Actually, no, we're going to heat them up. So we are ready to go. All right. Welcome again. Glad you guys take time out of your busy Saturdays to join us for iBUG Apple Workshop. And we are going to just jump right into doing some introductions. Sandhya, if you can unmute everybody, we want you to say your name, where you're calling from. And we got a little icebreaker question. Since it's so hot, we all like a cool drink. And to help those drinks stay nice and cool, we add a little bit of ice. So what's your preference, cube or crushed ice? Very simple, cube or crushed should be your answer. All right, let's start it up. Who wants to go first?
Taylor.
Sailor, hit it, man.
Taylor, I'm in the Woodlands right now, and my favorite ice is crushed. Especially, I like the slushy ice.
All right, one for Crush. Welcome, a Sailor. Who's next?
Gary Sauerman from Arlington Heights, Illinois. Crushed.
All right, way to go, Terry. Another crushed. Come on. Who's next?
Kathy from Pennsylvania. Ice cubes.
All right, Kathy. We got a cube lady coming out. All right. Who's next?
Diet Coke.
Bridget from Georgia, crushed.
Yeah, baby, Bridget. We love that crushed.
Ned from Kyle, Ned. Texas, cubed.
All right, we got another cubed. Welcome, Ned.
Thank you.
Julie from Ventura, cubed.
All right, Julie. Thank you. Welcome.
From Houston, cube.
All right, Jose. Welcome.
Your favorite, Dana from Cincinnati, crushed.
Mr. Dana, I would have guessed you were a cubed also, but we will take that crushed. All right.
Well, some people call me square, but you know.
I didn't mean that at all, but go ahead. All right, let's go. Let's go.
Jackie Boomster, Grand Rapids, Michigan, crushed.
All right, Jackie from Michigan, welcome.
Dan, Southern California, I'm a cube guy.
All right, Dan, welcome, Southern Cal.
Kenny from Missouri, no ice.
Kenny, a no ice man, likes it straight. All right.
Faith from Georgia, fresh.
I'm sorry, I got mixed in there, two of you, sorry.
Faith from Georgia. Crushed.
Okay, welcome. Welcome, Georgia.
Jody from New Hampshire, crushed.
All right, Jody, welcome.
Hi, Michael.
Anybody else out there that we didn't get a chance to introduce yourself?
This is Denise from Georgia, crushed.
All right, welcome, welcome. If anybody joined us before we got to say, you're just introducing yourself, where you're from, and if you like either crushed or cubed ice preference.
Hi, this is Vincent, New Jersey, no ice.
Uh-oh, we got another straight up guy. All right, all right.
Sharon from Georgia, cube.
All right, welcome, Sharon. Anybody else? Don't want to miss anybody out there.
This is Sandhya, cube.
Sandhya, all right, another cubed. I don't know. I think the crushed had it a little bit in head there. Actually, I was surprised because I was going to say no ice either. That's my choice. But anyway, that wasn't one of the picks, but who cares? All right. Let's see.
Mary Linda. Hello.
Hello, Mary Linda. Go ahead.
I'm from Georgia.
Welcome.
I just joined. I'm sorry, I didn't hear the original question. My
What's your preference, cubed or crushed ice?
Crushed.
All right. Way to go, crushed. Anybody else that we missed? Go ahead, Sri.
Crushed.
All right, very good. Crushed is definitely in the lead.
Greg, all right. Texas, cube.
Okay, keeping it up, Greg. Way to go, man. Crushed. Oh, no, you said cubed. Anybody else? Did we miss anybody? All right, let's see. I think there may have been one or two people that this is your first time here at the iBUG Apple Workshop. If you could just come back on, we'll just have a quick little question for you. First timers.
This is Sharon. This is my first time.
Sharon, and remind me again where you're from, Sharon.
I'm from Atlanta.
Atlanta, all right. Are you a friend of Bridget's?
I think I recognize Bridget's voice.
Okay. Bridget pretty much runs Atlanta, but anyway. All right. Well, how'd you hear about us?
Through GLS.
GLS, Georgia.
Library.
Oh, library. Okay.
Yeah.
Did you hear our presentation there about iBUG? Or? Oh,
no.
Okay.
This is all my right. First iBUG experience.
That was 2 years ago.
What kind of Apple devices do you own?
I have an iMac, an iPad, and an iPhone.
Wow.
All right. You got it all. Way to go. Well, we are so glad to have you join us.
Thank you.
Any other first timers? You're a little
Jackie loud. Boomstra.
Jackie, where are you from?
Grand Rapids, Michigan.
All right, that's right, Michigan. And how did you hear about us, Jackie?
I got an email.
Okay.
I got an email from you guys.
Oh, okay. You must be on our mailing list then.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Well, very good. And what Apple devices do you have?
I have two iPhones.
Two iPhones, one for each hand. That is awesome. Woo! You go, girl. All right. Well, welcome. Glad to have you here.
Mary Linda. I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm from Georgia. I've been on some of the other events, but never on this one. So thank you.
Okay. Well, glad to have you. And what kind of Apple devices do you have?
The only thing I have is an iPhone.
Okay. Well, very good. Which iPhone do you have?
The 13. Just got it last Christmas.
Ooh, the 13. That's the latest and greatest until another month from now. All right. Well,
then I had a 7, so.
Yeah, that's a big step up. Well, we are so glad to have you with us, Mary Linda. All right. Anybody else out there, first timers?
This is Julie. It's my first time for this workshop.
Okay, Julie, and remind me where you're from.
I'm from Ventura, California.
Ventura, all right.
Yeah, I have two tablets, Apple tablets and a Mac. I just got the Mac, so it's an M1 mini, and wow, it's awesome. I'm enjoying it, but I don't know much about it, so I've signed up for those classes with them.
Yeah. We got our intro Mac training coming up pretty soon.
And I have an Apple Watch. I need to learn a little about that, but that's okay. It tells me the time. That's all that matters now.
Okay. Well, it'll do a lot more than that as soon as you learn, and we are here to help you learn how to use that thing.
Thank you.
All right. Very good. Anybody else? First timers? We got quite a few first timers here today.
This is Denise from Savannah.
Denise, welcome. And what Apple products do you have?
I have the iPod Touch and iPad.
All right. Well, great.
Where are you from again? Where's she from?
Savannah.
Oh, Savannah. Boy, I tell you, we're represented well today from Georgia.
Georgia's got it covered. And how did you hear about us, Denise?
I received an email from Vanessa from the Library Services for the Blind.
Okay. Very good. Glad we did that. Vanessa, thank you. Yeah, so. glad we did that presentation to their library service area over there. All right. Anybody else? Don't want to miss anybody. First timers. All right. Well, let's get right into it. What's next on our agenda? I think we've got to make a few announcements. No. We got to recognize birthdays and anniversaries. How can I forget? One of the most important things. Anybody have a birthday or an anniversary of any kind in August?
Of any kind?
What is that? Terry Walker?
Yeah, Terry.
August the 27th.
August the 27th, coming up. Well, happy birthday, sir.
Thank you.
Virtual hugs.
Anybody else?
And I owe you many of them, Sandhya. I owe you billions of them.
All right. Keep going. What do we have? Go ahead.
Anybody else? Birthdays or anniversaries in August? Okay. Very good. Only one. I think I know of a few others that people that aren't happen to be here today, but we will just wish them a virtual howdy doody happy birthday. Okay, let's get right into doing some announcements. Things coming up in the iBUG world. Coming up, our normal Monday night, the iBUG Buzz at 7 p.m. right here on this very same Zoom channel, Zoom conference. And then Tuesday, we have the Mini Buzz, which is just a shortened version of the regular Buzz, which both of those are Q&A help sessions for anyone with iOS devices. And the mini bus is 5 p.m. on Tuesday on the Clubhouse app. Then Tuesday, right after that, about an hour after that ends at 7 p.m., we have iBUG Mac and Talk. Anyone with issues, questions about their Mac, that Tuesday night, right there, August 23rd at 7 p.m., join in right here on this very same Zoom line. Then we move on to Thursday, we have It's iBUG's Life. That is our session where we look at different ways to non-tech related things to help the blind, tips and tricks on doing things. And guess what? We're going to let the good times roll. We will be preparing and cooking some New Orleans style beans and rice. And we'll be demonstrating how to do that. I think it's going to be actually done in live in person, and I'm going to be sitting there waiting for the results. That'll be Thursday, August 25th at 6 p.m. 6 p.m.
Red beans
and rice. And remember, all these times I'm saying are Central Time. And then finally, Friday night, rounding out the week, our regular iBUG night at the virtual movies, where we get together and have a little pre-movie social, lots of fun and frolicking. And then the movie will start around 8 p.m. And then afterwards, we critique the movie, discuss it, comment, say how much we loved it or how much we appreciate the iBUG team for picking out that great movie, and have some trivia along with that. So that will be on Friday night, 8 or join in at 7:30 p.m. right here on this very same Zoom conference. All right, that rounds out everything coming up over the next week. But if you want to know more about all the other events that we do, we actually do 21 events each month. And you can go to our website, ibugtoday.org, ibugtoday.org. And there you can, there's a tab that says upcoming events, and that will list all the different events. You can also get on our mailing list on our website. Click the link, find the link that says register to join iBUG, and there's a simple form to put in your name and email, and then you will get notices right in your email box with every upcoming event. So let's see, we have some social media. We're on Facebook. We've got a regular Facebook page. We have a Facebook group. Just do a search for iBUG Today for those and join in. That's a good place to get the announcements. The groups page is also another good place to get help in between our various meetings. Just get on there 24/7 and post your question. And we have people monitoring that can help you get those questions answered. All right. We're also on Twitter. If you want to follow us on Twitter, our handle is at iBUG Today. And that rounds out all the different social media. Sandhya, what's next? I think it's time for you to take over and tell us a little bit what's been happening in the Appleverse. Any news and rumors? I know the summer is always a slow time, but we are getting close to some special event.
We got some fun, cool, interesting, kind of some disturbing Apple news. So let's get started. Okay. AirTags are heavily featured in today's newscast. AirTags were helped to catch an airport handler. And this was in, where was this? In Asuka. Police detected this guy. He was stealing luggage from passengers at the airport. And then they tried to recover, they were able to recover up to $15,000 in jewelry and other items. And this is in Okaloosa County. I'm thinking it's in Alabama, or I'm not sure. It's 500 miles from here, but I can't figure out what state that's in, but I'm sure somebody knows. Anyway, so they found this guy. They tracked him down because the lady had an AirTag in her suitcase, and they went to his house, and they, you know, there it was. And so it looks like police officers are now learning how to use the Find My app and trying to track people and items down. I mean, there's been a lot of controversy for some of these air tags, but they are also helping people find their lost property. So that is a good thing.
And you know what happens when you steal stuff that has an air tag, don't you?
No. Yeah, that's what we do in Texas. All right, next, Zoom has released a patch for its Mac app. It fixes a vulnerability in its automatic updating function that could grant Mac OS people the root privileges to an attacker. We don't want to do that, whatever that is. It was revealed at the DEFCON hacking conference. Why can't we ever go to something fun like that, right? Okay, anyway, on August 13th, Zoom released another patch for its macOS client, again, targeting the same vulnerability because they couldn't figure it out the first time. The security bulletin page describes the issue as affecting Zoom clients for macOS from version 5.7.3 onwards, with the patch itself bringing up the app until version 5.11.5. So definitely update your Zoom if you're using a Mac. Here we go. AirTags again. A UK man has been sentenced to 9 weeks. 9 weeks in prison after using AirTags to stalk his ex-partner. He apparently put it on the bumper, and she didn't know that it was there after they broke up. And when she got her new phone, she was getting little alerts saying, hey, there's an AirTag nearby, but she didn't know what that was. So later on, they figured it out, and, well, he got some serious, well, not too serious, only 9 weeks of time. Okay, now, and so, again, police are using tracking devices and to Find My app to help stalking victims. So that's a good thing. Now, what do we expect for Apple in September? The iPhone 14 event. And we already know now that that will be on September 7th. And every year the anticipation grows as to Apple will, what will it release in the fall, and all kinds of new stuff. Some things get an upgrade and some things are all new. So here's what we can, we're thinking about what was going to be coming. Like, it's just like clockwork every year, right? So what are we going to get? There's going to be some new things that we can buy at the shopping season, which is a very lucrative time for Apple, right? Because that's when I make my list. The main thing is the iPhone 14. It'll bring two models as usual, but there will be a big shift in size. So instead of the iPhone 14 and 14 mini, there will be instead iPhone 14 and 14 Max. And it is rumored that from the images of the models will have a 6.1-inch or a 6.7-inch display. And these are sizes that were comparable to last year's model, so that's pretty good. There will be not many changes on the outside, but there could be some internal changes. Apple could be sticking to the same A15 chip for the non-Pro models and then use the upgrade for the A16, but we are just not sure yet. Of course, this is all speculation. According to analysts, our favorite, Ming-Ji Kuo, the RAM of the standard models could jump from 4 gigabytes to 6 gigabytes. Other features that may stay the same here's some new stuff. The first noticeable change for this will be the display. The rumors indicate that Apple will switch to an always-on version. Some of these people may already have seen that with the Apple Watch. Such a feature will provide, at a glance, details for users without waking up and illuminating the entire phone. So that will save battery. That display will also apparently switch out the notch, you know, that notch at the top of the phone for a pill and hole cutout. Okay, pill and hole cutout, significantly reducing how much of the display is wasted on by the onboard true depth camera. So that's what is taking up all that space right now. There's also going to be a 48 megapixel wide camera, and that will result in the ability to record 8K resolution video and creating more detailed 12 megapixel images using pixel binning. That's what it is. Pixel binning or binning. I think it's binning. Okay, rumors propose that the A16 could be reserved for the Pro line, which could, that's a good thing. So we'll see what happens there. Just hold on till September. The Apple Watch range, you'll have three variations. So bringing out a Pro version alongside the standard Apple and the SE. So that will be the probably the more rugged version that we've been hearing about. And it's going to be kind of pricey. It could be up to $900 for that. So be on the lookout. That's the Pro model. And that could be rather big. It could be 4.7 millimeters. So that is rather large. Okay. Let's see. Then, and we'll have some fitness features as usual. So let's look out for that. Build up your muscles so you can have the watch. Next, it's about the AirPods Pro. They're going to get an upgrade. And
Time out.
What? Time out. Okay, can I talk about the last best thing? Best thing, real quick.
Roomba. Oh, this is from the September event?
Huh?
This is going to be at the September event?
No, this is just an aside.
Well, hang on for your aside.
Okay.
Well, regarding the September event, we got to let everyone know all of these things you've been saying are just rumors. Some of them are very good rumors and probably will turn into truths. But if you join us Sunday, September, what is that, the 11th? I believe September 11th. We will have iBUG Cafe, where we're going to spend the entire 2 hours talking about the event, all of the new hardware, the iPhones that have come out, and the software upgrades and the features and those that especially would affect any blind users and the screen readers and voiceover. So be sure to join us for that, and more information will be coming out, of course, prior to that time. All right, get back to it.
All right. Okay, so AirPods Pro are going stemless, okay? So we'll see what that looks like. Some changes in the model, including stemless design, whatever that means, and they will be departing wildly from the existing AirPods aesthetic. So wonder what that means. Let's find out. Put it on the list, shopping list. There will also be other claims that there will be some form of fitness tracking functionality. But well, again, like we said, these are all speculations. Rumors have also suggested that it could have a microphone in the charging case, a form of hearing aid functionality, and a case speaker to assist with Find My Recovery. That's pretty cool. The Apple could release the AirPod Pro cases equipped with USB-C ports for all of its wireless headphones in 2023. According to Apple, and now, oh, here we go, Ming-Ji Kuo again, and Kuo made the prediction that in a tweet on Tuesday. So he said that the second generation AirPods Pro models launched in 22 would ship with a lithium charging case. Lightning, sorry. And then, so we'll see about that. This is partly driven by the European Union regulation that will require the court standard to be standardized on iPhones and iPods models starting in 2044. And that law was aimed at reducing electronic waste and boosting what is this interoperability by passing earlier 22 back C. Okay, whatever that means.
Easy Steve for you to say.
Yeah, right. Steve Jobs, his turtleneck, the guy who designed the iconic turtleneck, his name is Miyake, dies at age 84, died of liver cancer, which I think is, well, okay, so anyway, this fashion designer died on August 5th after a long battle, okay, and he was born in Hiroshima and actually witnessed the atomic bomb, but he became famous because Steve Jobs and him were friends, and so he got 100 different black t-shirts from the designer, and so he wore them and became famous, and some people mocked him. The garment that became like an icon, like we said, his signature look, right? And then, you know, other people, remember the Theranos, remember we read the book, the bad blood, Theranos founder Elizabeth Holmes, and ardent fan of Steve Jobs, she also started wearing black turtlenecks to act like her hero. Who knew? Okay, I'm getting close. Okay, with my two favorite companies now, Amazon and iRobot, are merging. So there could be some concerns about security as well, right? So because this will allow Amazon to get an image of your entire home, because that's what the robot does. Okay, so they Amazon wants to be everywhere inside your home, and like we said, anybody who's concerned about safety and so forth is rightfully concerned. They announced the $1.7 billion with a B acquisition for iRobot. So Amazon is going to buy iRobot, and then we'll see what happens. Then so Alexa can do a lot more in your house besides vacuuming. And so although it is not proven, many privacy experts are concerned about the deal. And acquisitions and mergers are reviewed, and so we'll just see if this comes to fruition or not. I think that is it. There's a lot of other stuff that we're thinking about, so we'll just see. Okay.
All right. What did you say anything about the recent Apple vulnerability that was announced this past week? This past Wednesday,
yeah.
I think.
I did not, but they said that it's not any more serious than other ones, but it's just been made a big deal in the media.
Yeah, and the fix has already been out, so definitely everyone should go and update your devices. If you got an iPhone, iPad, Macs. When I upgraded mine, it takes about 5 minutes to update an iPhone or an iPad. On my Mac, it was over half an hour. I'm not sure why it took so long, but anyway, that's a security update, definitely needed. That gets you up to, if you're on your iPhone, it's iOS 15.6.1 is the update that you want. So be sure to do that as soon as possible. Not during this next hour and a half, but after that, you can go do that. Okay, very good. Thank you, Sandhya. Great news from all around the Apple world. I think we're ready to move on to our next segment. So what do you say? Let's go. We are ready for ours. We have a special guest with us today. And this is someone I just met about a month ago on another presentation. And so we are going to have him come and talk with us. And that is Tyler Merren, who's the owner, head honcho, chief bottle washer for Revision Training LLC. And they make the Revision Fitness app. So he's going to tell us about this new fitness app. All right, Tyler, take it away.
I appreciate it, Michael. Thank you so much for having me on. So, as Michael said, my name is Tyler Merren. I am visually impaired. I'm blind. I was born with retinitis pigmentosa and been a personal trainer and elite athlete, a motivational speaker for a very long time. And I think that to get a good grasp of, you know, kind of this project and the scope of it and what we're looking for with it, I'm going to rewind the tapes a little bit, just give you a little backstory on it. And then I'm going to demo the app for you guys live and definitely have lots of time for Q&A as well. So as we go through this, if you guys have some questions, I'm good either way of just kind of doing it at the end, or if somebody wants to raise their hand and interrupt, I'm okay with that too. So y'all let me know.
Yeah, I think we've got everybody muted where they cannot unmute until after the end of your presentation.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Totally fine. So just, I guess, hold the questions and we'll have plenty of time. So, I was born on a farm in Southwest Michigan. And like I said, grew up visually impaired. I have retinitis pigmentosa. So had a little better vision when I was younger, but you know, I was always active. I was always climbing trees and riding dirt bikes and digging holes and generally getting in trouble like kids should do. And as I grew up in this family of athletes and playing sports and things like that, my love for being active and being fit, it just never really waned as I got older and my vision got worse and worse. And so, you know, as a teenager, I started getting into adaptive sports. I competed and I still compete and have competed for the USA men's goalball team for the last 20 years. I've traveled all over the world doing that, 16 different countries. I've been in 4 Paralympic games, 4 world championships. I've collected 2 Paralympic medals, a bronze and a silver medal. And all of that, you know, led me into my career many moons ago of getting a bachelor's degree in exercise science from Western Michigan University and becoming a personal trainer in my pursuit to be the best athlete I could be, but also to share my knowledge and to teach. I've kind of got the heart of a teacher. I love to teach people. So all of that kind of culminates in this project. So really what we have is it's an app, a fitness program that was released several months ago. I've been working on it for about 3 years now. And the program is called Revision Fitness. And what it ends up being is a collection of my experience, my 10 years as a personal trainer, my 20 years as an elite athlete, and my 38 years as a person who's visually impaired. And it kind of combines it all into this program to help bridge the gap between people who are blind and fitness. And it, you know, it's something that I've known about for a long time, again, being in this realm and having to learn exercises and, you know, stay after classes, go to office hours and stuff to learn anatomy and physiology and biomechanics and how all of this stuff works. I knew for a long time that there was this gap there. And really, it came to a head a handful of years ago. I'm living in South Florida with my wife and my kids. My wife, who's also blind, we've been married 20 years now. I'm working full-time as a master personal trainer for 24-hour fitness. I'm an assistant fitness manager. And, you know, she's so connected and on a lot of groups and things like that. And so often I would come home from work and she'd, you know, hey, I, you know, so-and-so was on this group and they're asking about how to do fitness correctly. And, you know, you should really get on there and teach, you know, the blind community how to do this stuff that you've learned how to do. And, you know, I always, the timing never quite felt right. You know, I was working full time and moving up in the company that I was in, and just never really had the means and opportunity to do so. And a few years ago, I'm standing at the front desk of the fitness center that I worked at, and I'm waiting for one of my clients to come in. And this young lady came in. She was one of about four people out of the 9,000 that attended this gym who were visually impaired. So I struck up a conversation with her, and I, you know, just excited to see her. She'd been coming in pretty regularly, but she kind of had this dour mood. And so I'm talking to her, so, you know, what's going on? Why do you sound so glum? And she said, well, I've been coming into the fitness center pretty regularly, you know, last couple of months, 3 days a week. I've been walking on the treadmill for about an hour every day, and it's been going really well. I've been losing weight, but then it just kind of stalled out. You know, I'm not getting any better at this moment. I'm not losing any more weight. And I said, well, you know what? That's honestly, that's pretty normal. You know, I'm a personal trainer here. So if I ask you a couple of questions, do you take any classes? Do you do any strength training? You use any of the other machines, any balance or stretching exercises you do? She said, well, no, I don't really know how to do any of that stuff. And I said, okay, well, let's talk about it then. You know, I have training programs that I can set you up on. So, you know, the gym has particular packages and plans. I don't set any of my rates. You know, it's all set by the corporate office, but let's talk about it and let's see if we can get you set up on something. Well, unfortunately, she could not afford the rates. And it happened. I wasn't a very cheap date. I had a lot of experience, and as much as I wanted to train her, I wasn't allowed to. And, you know, she walked away disappointed, and I was disappointed for her. And I thought, you know what? It's just, it really wasn't fair. At that moment, it really kind of struck me, right? And of all the people, and I trained hundreds of clients, and there were many others that, you know, weren't able to hire me as a trainer. And I thought, you know, all those other people who were not able to hire me, you know, at least they could go upstairs into the fitness area and they could look around and say, okay, you know, okay, that's what that person's doing. I could probably do that. And they could sit down on the machine and look at the picture and, okay, this is where I put my arms and legs, and go into a classroom and just kind of watch the instructor. They could pull up a YouTube video. They had a lot of options still, but this young lady did not. She's a single mother, couldn't afford a personal trainer. And there just wasn't anything really accessible for her to help figure these things out. And that's what really kind of started this. You know, I started doing some research, and I started thinking about, well, what if I did set something up? What would I do? I had an opportunity to peacefully, cordially step away from the company I was working for. I opened the doors to my own company, Revision Training LLC, which is kind of a conglomeration of my personal training and motivational speaking. And so that's where Revision Fitness got kicked off. Spent years making notes and designing and talking to people and recording and scripting and working with a development company to set up the actual app. And happy to announce that about 4 months ago, 5 months ago, Revision Fitness, the audio fitness app, is live on iOS, Android, and it is a website as well at revisionfitnessapp.com. So, and we've got a lot of people signing up, a lot of people checking it out. I'm going to actually demo the app real quick, give you an idea what you're going to find. But again, if you're looking for it, you can just open up, the app store and just search Revision Fitness. It's capital R, lowercase e, capital V. But you know, however you type it in, you're going to find it's just a little play on words for the name of the app and the name of my company. But Revision Fitness, free to download, free to set up an account. And there is a 2-week free trial. And after that, there's a very, very small subscription. And I'll explain that to you and details as well. So let me open up my phone, and I'm going to demo this app for you real quick. Hopefully I will get a good sound here for you guys. I want to make sure I'm not making this too quiet. So I guess Michael, jump in if it's not coming through real clear. So once you, what you're going to find once you download the app, pretty simple. You're going to find an open screen where you can either log in or sign up. And so once you sign up, there's just some information you'll put in, first and last name, email and phone number, a password. And then you click sign up and it starts your 2-week free trial automatically. It'll take you back to the login screen. You just plug in those credentials you created and you will be good to go just like that. It stays logged in very easily. Once you're in, it opens up nice and easy. I have not seen a single crash report. The app tends to be pretty stable. So what you're going to find when you open it up, there are 5 tabs across the bottom, and I'll go through those with you real quick. So the very first one that we have.
Selected. Dashboard. Tab.
So the very first one is a dashboard. So this is a tab, and I'll go through these in a little more detail. This is a tab where, you know, we start to build a sense of community. One of the things when I began this project, I really didn't want it to just be, hey, here's some audio workouts, go ahead and do them. I know people, being a trainer for as long as I have been, I know people, and people need community. They need motivation. They need guidance. And so the dashboard is a place where I put up announcements and updates to the program, a place where you can comment and like things and start to build that sense of community. The next tab.
Classroom. Tab. 2 of 5. Button.
So the next one is the classroom tab. And this is where a lot of the actual learning will happen. Okay. So when I created this program, one of the things I wanted to do was make sure that if you were not sure about exercises, like particular exercises, that you could go into this section of the app and get all of the details that you need from, you know, how to start it, how to actually go through it, what you're supposed to feel, how to modify it. So there's over 150 lessons in the classroom tab describing very, very basic beginner exercises to super advanced stuff, yoga, stretches, strengthening exercises. There's quite a bit of content in there already. And I'm always adding more stuff to it. There's going to be much, much more added as we go along. The next tab.
Fitness studio. Tab. 3 of 5.
Button. So this is the actual fitness studio. And again, we'll dive into these a little bit, but this is where you actually find the audio workouts. So there is roughly 50 different workouts in the program already. Every studio tends to have, there's only a couple of exceptions, but most every studio has a beginner and an advanced level. So if you're somebody who's very new to fitness, you want to start off real light, you can click on the beginner section and it's a much, much lighter version of the workout. And I'll demo some of those. The fourth tab.
Fitness plan. Tab. 4 of 5.
So here's your actual roadmap. I put in fitness plans where you can actually get step-by-step guidance on, you know, if you're just getting started, you want to know kind of how to put these workouts together. This is going to be the place for you to check out. I always say that if the classroom lessons are your ingredients and the fitness studio is your cookware, the fitness plans is your actual recipe. It's how you get the meal on the table. It's how you get to your goals. So, and then the last tab is a more section tab where there's you know, terms and conditions. There's a contact us button. There's some other things. There are going to be a lot more features added there. I'm working on some updates to the app that I think you're going to really, really enjoy. But let me take you into the dashboard tab button. And just kind of show you an example.
12 days favorites. Button.
So this is one of my more recent posts. 12
yoga balance studio session just added to the fitness studio. The beginner level workout, which is 25 minutes long, starts with some very basic balance poses and gets a little more difficult. The advanced level flows through several progressively more elite sequences to really challenge your balance. Try both levels and find a place that is right for you to continue to practice and improve your skill. The winner of the $50 gift card, tap to like.
Okay. Count, so we recently did a $50 gift card drawing for members who are signing up. So there's some information there. There's a button here where you can like it and there's comments that you can check out. So different people jumping on there and talking about the workouts and how they're doing with them. So, and there's many of these posts that you can go back through all the way to the beginning. Just good information about fitness and general tips and updates. So lots of good information here. classroom. Going to the tabs at the bottom, I'm going to select classroom.
Two of five.
And so what you're going to find is we have a whole list. So it ends up being one big list, but it's broken down into sections and it's searchable by section. So there's a search box you can look at. There's a drop-down box to sort these exercises by, you know, beginner foundational movements, more advanced movements, yoga movements, abdominal exercises, core work, things like that. So one of the things that you'll find in this, so I'm just going to pick a random lesson here.
Foundational positions and movements, lesson four, scapular elevation and depression, shrugging and dropping your shoulders, button.
So this is at the top of the list, I have foundational positions and movements. So this is for folks who are, you know, really new to this whole thing and they really just get a good feel for how their body is supposed to move and what they're supposed to be doing. So I'm going to go ahead and click on this lesson. I'm going to open it up and what we're going to find is that you have
depression, shrugging and dropping your shoulders.
You have two options. You can either read the lesson with your voiceover or your braille display. I have it in text, for example.
Exercise purpose, to learn the neutral height for the scapula, shoulder blade. Reference, wall. To get into the starting position.
Okay, so I go through the whole lesson. Or at the bottom, I can swipe right and go to this button that says audio description. And when I click that.
Audio description, pause, button.
Revision fitness.
Let's change the way we look at it.
Scapular elevation and depression, shrugging and dropping your shoulders.
So exercise I will actually purpose, read this for you.
Height for the scapula.
So foundational it back, is, back, it's great back. Because then you have options, right? You can kind of be a little more hands-free. You can hit the button and you can kind of go through the movements as I'm reading it to you. You can read it with your screen reader. You can speed it up that way if you want to just do your screen reader. So giving you some options. And that is, I found giving those layers, not only is it more helpful for those who are a little bit hard of hearing as well, if they can't get the audio as easily, they can read the text that way, but it also gives users a lot of options. If you're a speed reader with your voiceover, you can flick through it a lot quicker. And then I'll quickly demo the fitness studio section. There's several other features that I'm just kind of glossing over right now. As you play around with the app, you'll see them. There's some favorites options and stuff. So, you know, some quick shortcuts to some of your favorite stuff. But the fitness studio is set up very much like the classroom where it's a big list. You've got a search option. There's some drop downs. I'm going to go ahead and just pick a random abdominal workout here.
Session. Core workout targeting the abdominals button.
Okay, so here we have an abdominal workout. There's stretches and balance workouts and cardio and lighter and easier ones. I'm going to go ahead and just open this one.
Abdominal blast circuit description. Coupling some of these basic abdominal exercises together with a single posterior chain movement will help target those abdominals in a way that should have you feeling it both during and after the workout. Remember right. That modified so pre-workout information.
There's a whole description here of what the workout is, the list of exercises, a short description of each one. So it's multi-layered. And I get this question sometimes, hey, do I have to go through all 150 classroom lessons in order to do these workouts? No, you certainly do not. So each description, when you open up a fitness studio, I've got all the exercises listed and there's a quick description in here of each exercise. So if you're like, oh, okay, I remember what that is. I know how to do that. Then you're good to go. If it's like, ooh, I don't really get it. Then you can go back to the classroom and get all of the details for each one. Every exercise in these workouts is in the classroom, super well described. There's a pre-workout information button. So, again, an audio-based recording where I kind of describe the workout, I describe all the exercises. So it's like hey, what's this workout all about? And then you actually have the studio sessions themselves. There's a beginner level and advanced level. I'll go ahead and just click on one of those.
Studio session workouts, abdominal blast, circuit 12 round beginner 11 minutes button.
So it says it's 11 minutes long. This is the beginner level. Let me go ahead and click on that.
Abdominal blast, repeat off button.
Revision fitness.
Let's change the way we look at it.
Welcome into the Abdominal Blast circuit training.
So now I actually, I have zero the play. Background music toggled off because I was demoing this earlier. So I'm going to hit the play with music play button. Music. So you have the option to play with or without background music. Again, kind of more beneficial for the hard of hearing.
Welcome into the Abdominal Blast circuit training.
So there, same track session. With some background music for you. There's different music for each workout.
12-round circuit.
App back button.
There
back.
We go. And I take you through it that I actually do the entire workout with you. There's timers that are built into most every workout. So it's real easy to follow. I take you through every step of it. So, abdominal and then blast, at the the last one, the fitness plans, I'll go ahead and just kind of let you explore that one. That's again, similar idea. There's a couple of basic fitness plans that are in there right now. So a tone up fitness plan, a lose weight fitness plan. And it just kind of walks you through week by week, like what workouts you should put when, which days you should have rest days. It's a general guide, you know, things that you can modify as you go along, and I talk through all of these workouts about, hey, if you know, if this is a little tough, go ahead and modify it. There's different options for you to make it tougher or make it easier, whatever you're trying to do. So real kind of brief overview of what the program looks like. I tried to keep it as concise as I could while giving you the meat of the meal. So that is about it. There's a 2-week subscription, I'm sorry, a 2-week free trial. And then after that, you can choose to subscribe either monthly or annually. And it's, again, it's really reasonable. So it's a $5.99 a month subscription or $59.99 for the year. Just to put that in context, when I was working as a personal trainer, a single session with me cost more than $60. So, you know, to sign up for a year of this, you get a year of totally accessible fitness that is going to continue to grow and expand. I'm adding stuff to it all the time for what it would cost for a single session with a personal trainer typically. So pretty reasonable subscription rates, and that helps me to keep the program up and running. I've gotten several scholarships and awards, most recently from the NFB, the Jacob Bolotin Award. I received the Holman Prize from the Lighthouse of San Francisco for this project. So lots of people signing up, lots of support. And just a final before I take some questions, really the thing for me is I want this program to be a couple of things. The first is I want it to be a program for the blind by the blind, right? I think that there has been some attempts in the past to make something accessible, and some people have done some really good work. I want to take it even further. We deserve to have something that's accessible and totally made for us. You know, there's a lot of work to be done with it yet. But I think that if we can all kind of come together and make this program the best it can be by providing feedback and supporting it and sharing it, I think this could really be a big resource, because I want it to be a household name. I want this to be the one-stop shop where anybody who's blind or visually impaired can get whatever information on whatever type of fitness they want. So with that, I've been yapping at you guys for a while. So I want to pause, and I would love to hear any thoughts you have, answer any questions you have on this presentation.
All right. What an awesome app. Just sounds great. I've played with it just a little bit myself, but I haven't gotten into it in depth. Let's see. Okay. Very good. Thanks so much, Tyler. That was super, super. We are going to unmute and let people, again, say your name and wait to be recognized, and then you can ask Tyler a question about the Revision Fitness app.
Sailor.
Go ahead, Sailor.
This app, what's this app called again?
It's called Revision Fitness. It's R-E-V-I-S-O-I-N, Revision Fitness.
I can't wait to try. R-E-V-I-S-I-O-N?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Can't
yep.
wait to try and, it.
Yeah, should be able. I think when you do the search in the App Store, they usually have a couple of the sponsored stuff at the top and things like that. But it's like the third swipe through or whatever as you get through those apps. It's pretty easy to find. The publisher is Revision Training LLC. It's my company.
Did you develop it, or did you develop it on your own, or who?
No. I wish I had that skill set. No, I paid a developer to actually put the framework of the app together. But when you open it up, all the recordings, all the text, all the lessons and the structure, it all came out of my head in my research. But the actual coding for the app is a company I hired.
Good job, Tyler.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
All right. Anybody else? Go ahead, Sri.
This is Chris.
So Tyler, great presentation. I'm looking forward to going from my one pack to the six pack.
I like it.
My question is, the yoga, like how descriptive are you so that we're making the poses correct? Because I find myself, I'm trying to do my yoga pose, but I'm apparently not doing it in the right posture.
Yeah, for sure. So as I go through, and this is true for yoga and it's true for all of the other lessons that I utilize, that I've created. So I use reference points and clock face directions to really try to help make sure that people are in the right position, you know. So you're doing a crescent pose, for example, in yoga. You know, I talk about, okay, your feet are separated. You've got 1 foot forward, 1 foot back. Okay. So they're kind of in line. Your front knee is bent. Your back leg is straight. Both sets of feet are pointed forward. Both, all your toes are pointed straight ahead. Your hips are closed. So your hips are pointed straight ahead. Your chest, belly, shoulders, everything is looking at 12 o'clock. Your arms are up. You're driving your back heel towards the floor. Like, it's almost overkill. There's a lot of description in there to try to make sure that people really are grasping it. And if there's ever a lesson that you come across that you're like, you know, this just doesn't get it quite right, I still am not sure, because I'm always looking to tweak and adapt. And, you know, I've been doing this so long that sometimes I try to think of every detail, but sometimes I kind of breeze through something and like assuming that I'm getting the right description. So there's a contact us section in the app where it goes directly to my email, and so plenty of opportunity to provide feedback on anything you find as well. But you should be good. You should be able to find all the description you need to make sure you're in the right zone.
Thank you.
Great.
I think Chris was waiting.
Yeah, Chris is up next.
Hi, Tala. Congratulations on your app. I have a few things. So number one, are you the only instructor? Like, how many instructors? Is it just you? And as far as music, do you have a choice of music types, or is it just music on or off? And what type of equipment do you use? Is it strength or barbells or bench or, you know, what have you, or treadmills, that kind of thing? And last but not least, if you do maybe like 100 exercises, you forget which ones you've done, is there a way in the app that lets you know that you've already taken a class? Thanks.
Great. Super good question. So let me see if I can make sure I get them all. So as of right now, I am the only instructor. You know, the program just recently launched and just trying to kind of create a good base, a good foundation. But I'm actually currently in conversation with several other blind instructors, people who specialize in yoga and a few other things, because, you know, again, I want this to be a community thing, right? I've got my hands on the wheel right now because I really feel like I know what it needs to be and what direction it needs to go. But yeah, I'm planning on bringing in other instructors. You have to listen to my voice through all of them for now. So the music, it's a pre-recorded thing. So unfortunately, I don't have anything as of yet where you can like, okay, I want to choose rock or rap or classic or whatever for this workout. It's kind of an on and off thing. You know, if you toggle it off, that way you can maybe play whatever music you're comfortable with on another device or whatever. So not a perfect setup, something that I'm still kind of looking into as far as adding some other options for that. The equipment used. So right now, every workout on there is totally equipment free. So designed it that way to start with at the launch so that anybody could download it. All you really need is, you know, some space in your living room or whatever to be able to do all these workouts. As I'm adding more material, that will be expanding. So I've got a few other workouts that I'm going to post for some yoga and some kickboxing. After that, I've got resistance band workouts that I've got slated to put up. So doing some strength training, I'm going to be doing, you know, free weights and machines and cardio equipment, medicine balls, battle ropes, Bosu balls. I have just a massive list of stuff that I'm going to be building out over the next several months or even years as this thing grows. Right. So for now, all body weight, soon to be instruction on a lot of the other equipment. I think there was one more. I don't remember what the last one was. Well, if you could remind me of it.
Go ahead, Chris.
Yeah, if you've done 100 workouts, for instance, hypothetically.
Oh, and okay.
This is Chris.
Yeah, so tracking.
The one everybody taking a class that you've taken it.
Yeah, track. Nothing built in as of yet, but I'm got some stuff I'm talking with my developers about. It may be a while before those features and functions come out where it's like, okay, yeah, you've done this workout 12 times or 15 times or 20 times. There is a favorite sections to the app so that like, hey, I really like this workout or I really like this exercise or I'm practicing this one. You can favorite those exercises and it's a quick shortcut to the ones that you really like. But not a whole lot of tracking features as of yet. Definitely stuff that we're looking to add in the future.
Thanks.
Great. Thank you.
All right. Anybody else? Questions for Tyler?
Dana.
Go ahead, Dana.
Yeah, I think he answered my question, but I'm going to ask anyway. I have a resistance machine, full body machine here in my condominium. And I was going to ask if you have a resistance section in your app. Like I can do resistance training, but I'm confused on, you know, how many reps to do. And somebody trained me, you know, years ago on what to do, but, and I did what he told me to do, but, I just, need some little guidance. I was just wondering if you had something, you know, that could guide me a little more on what to do in resistance training.
Yeah. As I mentioned, right now it's a lot of body weight movements. So the build out of more like free weights, machines, that stuff is kind of, it's in the queue. It's just hasn't been reached quite yet. When I get to that spot, I'm going to have workouts that kind of guide you through, you know, upper and lower body workouts or a push pull split, or, you know, you can do this with free weight bench press, dumbbells, or a chest press machine, you know, and you can kind of follow the format of the workout regardless of which piece of equipment you might be using at that time. And so yeah, there will definitely be that built in, just not quite yet, unfortunately. So soon as I'm able, definitely going to put that out for you.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Appreciate it.
This is Tree.
Yeah, Tree. Go ahead, Tree.
Tyler, just out of curiosity, in your story, you mentioned the lady. Did she join your program?
You know, it's funny. I'm not in contact with her. She, this was 4.5-5 years ago, and she was somebody I knew at the gym. She wasn't necessarily a close friend of mine. I remember her name and all of that. So it would be interesting to look her up sometime and connect with her and tell her the situation. I don't even know that she realizes the path that she put my feet on. So it would be interesting to find out. So maybe I'll do a little digging.
This is Terry.
Sandhya, then Terry.
Just real quick. I mean, I know it's just starting out, but maybe one thought is like for some people who are, you know, mobility impaired, or I guess you could try to, you know, choose the lighter or easier versions. Where, like, for example, in the yoga, maybe a thought about like chair yoga or something. Is that an option now, or is it in the on the horizon?
Yeah, actually, it's funny you mentioned that, because that's actually the very next one. That's the one I'm working on right now, is a gentle chair stretch yoga. There's both floor and chair, so you'll have the option to do either one. So be very cognizant of that. A lot of the clients that I worked with when I was full-time training, you know, they had those kind of issues. There are a few things built in already. If you are kind of new to fitness, or you have, elderly, your challenges moving, I have a knee-friendly cardio workout, for example. It's a very low impact cardio workout. A lot of the beginner level, beginner level dynamic warm-up is something I try to recommend for a lot of people, because very low impact movements and basic stretches, kind of moving the body in all three planes. So the workouts, generally speaking, are kind of middle of the road right now. So they're not super advanced. They're not super beginner. And as I expand and put more material out, I'm kind of pushing towards each end of the spectrum. So some much lighter and some much more advanced workouts. But there should be something for just about everybody currently in the app.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, Terry Ann, you're on deck.
First of all, thank you for making this affordable. Of course, I realize that's a relative term, but let's say affordable for many people who are blind or visually impaired who would not otherwise be able to afford exercise training. And secondly, and forgive me if I missed this in your presentation, but do you have any sort of newsletter? Because you're continually doing updates to your app, do you have any newsletter that would alert people to updates, or do they just need to go to your website, or how does that work?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I appreciate the thanks on that. As a small side note for the actual cost of the subscription. Yeah, it ends up being something that's kind of relative, but I did my best to make sure it was something that, you know, almost on any budget people could afford to jump on. I really wanted it to be accessible, no barriers to fitness, right? So I appreciate that. And the best way to find updates for the app right now is to check the message board on the app. That's where I post all new stuff. But I do also have I have a Facebook group. It's called Revision Training with Tyler Merren, Fitness VIPs. Michael, I don't know if you want me to, I can provide that information if you have a mailing list or whatever, but that's another place that you can find some updates to the program. And that's more of a general fitness community for people who are blind and visually impaired as well. So lots of other information shared in there, accessible equipment and other things like that. Best way so far, as I'm kind of growing these things, I don't have a newsletter as of yet. So to check that message board, you're going to find all the things you'll need right there on the first page of the app.
If you, Tyler, if you had your automatic update set for, you know, your apps on the App Store, I mean, I would think it would automatically go ahead and update it as soon as you push an update through.
Yeah. So there's kind of two different ways that it's updated. So either it's an actual update to the app itself, which is, you know, the auto update that the App Store will do, or there's just when I add new material, right? I just added a yoga workout, or I just added these five new exercises or this fitness plan. That stuff is just, it's all internal, and Apple doesn't really care so much about that. They don't notify at this point. So, but other, again, things that I'm working on with my developer, I got a list of about 50 items that I'm sorting through with them, doing some push notifications and things that make it a bit easier to know when things are coming down the pipes for it too.
This is Sri.
Yeah.
And Sri.
So signing up, Tyler, you said that you can sign up using the web or the app. Does it make any difference in signing up to the program then?
No, it really doesn't. The cost is the same. Once you're signed up through one or the other, you can access either with the same login credentials. So it's just two different, if it matters to you on my side of things, it's just two different platforms. So one of them you pay through your Apple subscriptions services, which obviously is very convenient, very easy. If you do it on the web, once the 2-week trial is up, it'll ask you to put in card information, and that's all done through Stripe. So, you know, differences, but nothing that the user will really need to worry about.
Tyler, so it was developed for the smartphones, iPhone or Android. If you were to load the app onto a tablet, an iPad, for example, then it would still run. It would just be it would just be the iPhone version of it.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. No, yeah. It, as far as I've got people who use it on their iPads all the time. So as far as I know, it functions exactly the same, same way.
Okay.
Yep.
All right. Any other questions for Tyler?
This is Julie.
Go ahead, Julie.
I just wanted to know if you have to be connected to the internet using this app.
You do, because when we originally designed it, I didn't want it to be a really heavy app that took up a whole bunch of space on your phone. Like, you're not downloading all these workouts to your phone. So it is streamed. I feel like I say this a lot, but I'm talking to my developers about almost like Netflix, where, you know, you can, if you're subscribed, you can download movies to your device. It's a similar thing. I'm having conversations with my developers about, you know, being able to download workouts to your device if you're going to be offline. But that's we're looking at that as a future update.
All right, very good. Oh, sure, you're next.
Does it apply to family sharing, or is it just one user?
You know, I don't have a lot of information about the family sharing and how the app functions with that. I'd be interested if you took a look at it and let me know kind of how that how it worked with that. It's pretty user friendly right now. So, you know, I know that there are some families who, you know, have a credential that they share with each other, and that's acceptable from my perspective for the moment. Right. And the biggest thing for me is I want people to be able to access it. Right. I want people to be able to get the information. So family sharing is something I'm not super familiar with how the app will react, but love to get some information on it. If you're going to take a look at it.
Will do. Thank you.
Cool.
This is Vincent.
Yeah, Vincent, go ahead.
A couple of questions. The first one here. So each one of the sections has an area for advanced and for beginners and advanced.
Yeah. So the actual fitness studio. So when you open that tab, that's where all the actual audio workouts are. And so each one of those workouts, each one of those studio sessions has a beginner or an advanced section. Typically some of them have just one workout for everybody. So like there's a cool down stretch routine that's just kind of standard for everybody. There are a couple of studio sessions where there's multiple options. There's some preset timers, kind of a build your own workout section, but generally speaking, yeah, I give a lighter and a more advanced version for each workout.
Okay, thank you. And I mean, just out of curiosity, and I'm sure you have it in your app in there, you have a legal disclaimer that we use it at our own risk. And
yeah.
Okay. Yep,
for sure. Excellent. And, you know, it's just a CYA thing, right? Sure. But yeah, and I talked through, so one of the things I didn't get to touch on is, again, kind of building in my experience as a trainer, I have a series of lessons in the classroom called action group items. And if you do any of the fitness plans, I walk you through those action group items. But It talks about, you know, setting your goals and establishing your routine. And, you know, I mentioned there a few times, like, it is really important to be connected with your personal physician, you know, when you're increasing your activity. You know, generally speaking, anything and everything in this app is safe, because I am pretty experienced as a personal trainer, but everybody's different. And it's really important that you listen to your body and work with your personal physician on this stuff.
Right. If I may, another question.
Yeah.
For example, I still have a membership in the club, and I mean, this is an excellent opportunity, and I'm definitely going to take advantage of it, because I'm paying something like $75 a month for that. And the only reason I'm keeping it, you know, I have the same issues that the lady had in, you know, I know how to use certain machines, but other than those few machines, that's about it. And usually I spend more time locating the machines than exercising.
Sure. Sure.
So what I did is I have a rowing machine at home. I have a stationary bicycle, and I have some free weights. So I do that, like the rowing and the cycling. I just do that at, you know, at certain pressure, you know, and time it, and then pretty much go by time, and that's pretty much it. But is that something that will also be in the future taken into consideration, like how to use some of those less not complicated pieces of equipment?
Yeah, absolutely. So, and using bands and free weights and things like that are a lot closer in the queue than maybe some of the bigger, more complicated machines. But yeah, absolutely. And there's ways even now to kind of use some of the resources in there. So for example, if you have a rowing machine and you're comfortable with using it, because I haven't built in any lessons on how to use a rowing machine, right? But if you're comfortable with it already, I have some preset timers in there where you can just load a preset timer with some background music. And I say, like, okay, you know, this will tell you when to start and when to stop. And so you can do some interval training on the rowing machine with it. You know, again, it's not specifically designed for the rowing machine, but absolutely can be used that way. So, you know, there's some options built in, but yeah, as it goes on over the next months and years, as I build out this material there, a lot of that stuff will be built in, you know, hey, we're going to do a specific rowing machine workout today, and here's how we're going to do it. Or, you know, we're going to do an upper body free weight workout. You can use bands, you can use free weights and dumbbells. So here's, you know, let's go ahead and jump into it. So yeah, all of that will be forthcoming. I'm pretty excited to get that stuff out. It just kind of takes some time to build.
Thank you.
This is Sri.
Okay. So this will have to be the last question. We'll have to move on here.
Tyler, do you know if your app is tied to the Apple Watch?
So it is, it's not Apple Watch compatible at this moment. It's in that list, right? That long list that I've talked about, but it is something I do want to integrate it to Apple Health and the Apple Watch. So that's something that will be coming in the future, hopefully, as I'm working with my developers on this. Just bear with me for the moment as I get this thing off the ground. So yeah, I appreciate that though. And as we close up, you know, again, just kind of leaving you with this thought, it's this program, I'm going to keep going with it. I'm going to keep creating new material. I'm going to keep building it. But if I have your voices and your support, you know, giving some constructive feedback and, hey, have you thought about this, and using that contact us button to give me some thoughts on things, you know, sharing it with people and signing up and using it and all of that stuff, I think that this program could really impact a lot of lives for the better. So making it a mission for all of us to bring fitness to the entire blind community, I think would be great for all of us to partner on.
All right, very good. Again, Tyler, thank you so much for being with us and joining us, sharing your Revision Fitness app. Sounds like it's, you know, got lots of potential there. I mean, lots of capability already, but the potential for what it can be is just unbelievable in my mind anyway. And congratulations on your awards from the Holman Prize and the Blotin Award. I mean, that just speaks volumes that those organizations, you know, recognize the capability of the app and its, you know, value to the blind community. So,
thank you. I really appreciate it, Michael. Thanks for having me on and giving me a chance to speak.
Great, great. All right, let's see. Let's give a big round of applause for Tyler. All right, we are ready to move right along here. What we got coming up next, Sandhya? Let's go, let's go. All right, I think we've got another demo coming up.
Yes, we do, from one of our longtime iBUG members. So we're going to hear from David Cleveland, and he's going to be talking to us about something that we get many questions about. What's the best way to listen to an iBUG podcast?
All right. And just to let people know, this the recording of this demo was, the volume on it's a little low, so you may want to make sure you have headphones or turn up the volume. I've got my sound as best I can to play this back, but it still seems a little bit low. So here we go. And we'll have time for some questions afterwards. It's about a little over 16 minutes or so.
Hi, this is David Cleveland, a longtime iBUG member. And today I'm going to show you how to access the iBUG podcast using Apple Podcasts. We received questions from users on how to best get access to the many podcasts that are available on the iBUG Today website. Of course, you can still listen to them directly from the website, but it tends to be a little tedious and sometimes people have issues. So the recent changes we've made to allow the podcast to be in a podcast feed, you can pick them up with popular podcast apps, such as Apple Podcasts. So I will show you how to follow the iBUG podcast of your choice, and then how to play it and navigate through it. And hopefully that will allow you to make better use of all the resources that we have. Okay, let's start by opening Apple Podcasts. Open Apple Podcasts.
Podcasts. Search. Heading.
Now, this app is included on your phone or iPad. If you somehow do not have it, you may need to go to the App Store and re-download it. It's going to be under the name Podcasts. And, of course, it is produced by Apple, so make sure you're getting the Apple version. Of course, there are other podcast apps that people use, such as Downcast, Overcast, Castro, and other ones. But since this one is included in the phone and it's fairly straightforward, we're going to suggest you use this one to start out with. All right, so here we are in the podcast app.
Tab bar, listen now, tab, 1 of 4.
Okay, the first tab is going to be listen now, and that's what you're going to be brought to by default. These are tabs at the bottom. So the next tab over to the right is
browse. Tab.
Browse.
2 of 4.
Of course, you would use that if you're going to browse for a podcast by, say, the genre. Maybe you're looking for just general computer podcasts or podcasts about finance and so on. Then swipe one more time to the right.
Library. Tab. 3 of 4.
We'll give you library. One more time.
Selected. Search. Tab. 4 of 4.
Search. So we're going to start out actually in the library tab, which is the third tab. So we're going to swipe left.
Library. Tab.
Double tap.
3 of 4.
Here.
Selected. Library. Tab. 3 of 4. No shows yet?
Okay, it says no shows yet. So I have not added anything to my podcast library in Apple Podcasts. So let me flick down here from left to right.
Use the browse tab to discover powerful
browse.
Search for a podcast button.
Okay, we swiped on that again, and now we have the search. So let's double tap on that.
Search. Heading.
All right.
All podcasts.
Swipe
search
to right.
Field.
Okay, it's searching through
double
all podcasts. So this is going to search through every podcast that's available in the Apple Podcast universe, which is hundreds of thousands. So what I'll use is the dictate function, and it's pretty easy to find iBUGs stuff. So I'm going to double tap on the keyboard, two-finger double tap, do the dictate.
Dictate button.
iBUG.
Inserted iBUG. Search. Dimmed.
Okay, there we go.
Use the rotor to access iBUG Android Insight.
Okay.
iBUG Apple Workshop.
So it found it by just saying iBUG. You could also type in, of course, the letters I-B-U-G altogether, and it would do the same thing. And that's all you have to search for to find these.
iBUG Cafe. iBUG Buzz.
So, iBUG Buzz.
iBUG Cafe.
iBUG Cafe.
iBUG Apple Workshop.
iBUG Apple Workshop.
iBUG Mac and Talk.
The Mac and Talk.
iBUG Android Insight.
And the Android Show. So, I'm just flicking from left to right to go through the list of search results. So I'm going to go back to the old
nav bar.
iBUG Buzz. Let's double tap on that.
iBUG Buzz.
Okay.
Shows. Heading.
Now from here, if you wanted to, you could just play the most recent episode and be done with it. But it would probably be better if you would actually follow the podcast through this app, then you'd be notified when there are new episodes and be able to jump quickly to it when you go into the podcast app. But if you wanted to play episodes just from here, you go down.
iBUG Buzz, episodes, heading, see all, button.
Tap on see all.
Wednesday, July 27th, Saturday, number 500, Wednesday, episodes, Wednesday. Number 547, August 15, 2022.
So at this point, all you need to do is double tap on that one and play it. But like I said, I think it's best if we do a follow. So let's go back up to the top.
Search. Back Saturday. Number 5. Wednesday. Episodes. Search. Back. Episode. Wednesday. Number. Search. Search. Back button.
Back.
iBUG Buzz, iBUG Today, podcast artwork, image, a white sign with black, iBUG Buzz, podcast artwork, iBUG Buzz, iBUG Today, button.
Okay, iBUG Today, button. So that is the button that will take you to the actual screen where you can then follow the podcast. Let's double tap on that.
iBUG Today.
Opens up.
Podcast artwork, image, nav bar, follow, button.
Okay, there's a follow button. So if I want to follow this, I'll double tap.
Follow.
Unfollow. And then when I right,
more,
swipe.
Button.
There's a more button. Now if I left swipe to go back to follow.
Following, button.
It now says following. So that means I followed it. Similar thing happens like in Facebook, like something or what, say liked once it's done and stuff like that. So
more button.
Okay. All right. Swipe again to the more. There's a couple of things with more I'd like to point out. So double tap on more.
Unfollow show button.
Okay. There's the unfollow show button. If you want ever do that.
Settings button.
Settings. I just go with the default settings for this app. I mean, you can go in and tweak things, but I'm not really going to go into all that detail right now because we want to do a short demo.
Play next. But mark all as played. Share show.
Share button. Show. Now that can be helpful. If you want to tell a friend about the podcast, you can double tap on share show and it brings up the standard iPhone, iOS share sheet. You can do, mail, messages, the social medias and so forth.
Copy link button.
Copy link. That could be also used to copy a actual link to play the podcast, which you could post in your, so your Twitter feed, your Facebook, so on. Could be helpful.
Report a concern button.
No really concerns to report. I don't think we get too crazy on this podcast that we need to report issues. Sandhya keeps us in line.
Dismiss context menu.
Okay, button. Then we'll do dismiss. Back to the back screen.
Button.
The previous screen. All right, so let's start.
Resume. Button. This is a free weekly Q&A help session for more. Button. Technology.
Oh,
more. Button. This is a free weekly Q&A help session for anyone with iOS and iDevice, iPhone, iPad, iPod Touch, Apple Watch and Apple TV accessibility questions or issues. The first 45 minutes are dedicated.
Okay, well, that's the whole description. It's pretty long, so I don't want to play the whole thing.
More. Button.
More would give you more details on that.
Technology.
It's a technology podcast.
Episodes. Heading.
Here we are in episodes. So let's do...
see all. Button. Wednesday, number 547, August 15th, 2022. 2 hours left. Button.
Let us double.
Actions available.
Let's do the actions.
More. Save. Download.
Okay, you can download it if you want to download it for offline viewing, not viewing, listening. That could be handy if you're on a bus or somewhere where you may not have good Wi-Fi or you don't want to use your cellular data while you're on the road. I do that a lot with podcasts myself.
Played. Activate default.
Okay, so activate default would be to actually play it.
More.
Activate
default.
Let's do the activate default.
Artwork. Playback. Save episode. Off. Button.
And let's see. It should start playing.
Mini player.
Okay.
Double tap to expand the mini player.
Here's the mini player. That's what's going to give you your controls. So double tap on mini player.
Dismiss now playing screen. Album artwork. Track not playing. Track position. 0 seconds of 0 seconds.
Okay, so you see it's zero. It's not played anything yet.
Not playing.
It's not playing.
Dimmed. But go backward. Play. Button.
Okay, here's our play button. So we'll double tap on play.
Pause.
The iBug Buzz, episode 547 for August 15. I'm Greg. I'll be co-hosting tonight with
some play.
Okay, I just double tapped on pause to stop it from talking and interfering with me.
Fast forward.
Okay,
30
so you have,
second play button.
You have
fast forward. 30 seconds button.
30 seconds. That might be helpful if you want to fast forward through some of the introductory stuff that maybe is not relevant anymore, like stuff that's already happened. You can kind of skip ahead at a 30-second increment.
Volume 69%.
There's your volume
adjustable
control, which could also be, you know, controls.
Swipe
your,
up or down with one finger to adjust
with your regular iPhone controls.
Playback speed, normal speed.
Here, playback
button
speed. Now, some people enjoy listening to podcasts at a faster speed than normal speaking. You can get through things faster, and it kind of just makes it more digestible because you don't have to wait for pauses and things of that nature. So,
playback speed.
Let's try
normal speed. Button. Playback speed.
On that.
1.25 speed.
Now it's at 1.25. So let's try the play now.
For any of you that are new to the iBug Buzz, this is an open forum discussion where we encourage you to ask questions, bring up issues. Related to the...
Now, as you can hear, it's a little bit faster. It's still understandable. It's like, you know, 25% faster. That's my preference for listening to podcasts. And you can also do higher. You can do...
Playback speed. Playback speed. 1.5 speed.
1.5.
Playback speed.
Even 2x.
Double speed.
We'll just try 2x just for fun.
Accessibility features on your iOS devices. That would be the iPhone, iPad, iPod Touch, Apple TV, Apple Watch. And at this point, I'm going to turn it over to...
Now that's a little too fast for my taste. Now, if you want something kind of fun, you can also double tap again.
Playback speed, half speed.
And everybody sounds like they're really sleepy.
For announcements and a preview of iBug events that are coming up this week.
Yeah, not too handy, but it's kind of funny to listen to sometimes.
Playback speed. Playback speed. Normal speed.
I set it back to normal by double tapping on playback speed.
Playback destination.
iPhone. Playback destination. Of course, that's defaulted to your iPhone, but of course you could put it out to any AirPlay devices you have connected to your in your home and so on, like your AirPods, HomePods or your any Apple compatible speakers.
More button. Play volume. Fast forward. Play. Rewind. 15 seconds.
Rewind. Here button. We go. Rewind 15 seconds. So that's handy because when you're playing the podcast, if you just didn't catch something, you just want to go back a little bit and don't want to like go back a whole lot, you can kind of keep double tapping on this button to take yourself backwards. So let's try that. I'll start the podcast again by doing the two-finger magic tap.
All right, thank you, Greg. Yes, there's we have a busy week. All right, let's see something each day. All right, so all time pause, central, rewind, all things on Zoom, unless
rewind, preview rewind, on your iOS device. Rewind, Sandhya.
Rewind, rewind, 15 seconds. Pause, button, fast forward,
to
fast
the accessibility forward, features 30 seconds. On your iOS.
So there you go. I was just double tapping each time on 15. It took me actually to the very beginning, because it wasn't very long, but it's better than just like pressing and holding on rewind, because you never know when it's, you know, when you're going to get to, I don't know, I just find it more helpful.
Volume. Okay, 69%.
So that's pretty much the functionality of using the iBUG podcasts with Apple Podcasts. Let's go, I guess before I close, let me get it out of here, out of the mini player.
Album artwork, dismiss now playing screen.
Let's go dismiss now playing.
Back, topics, let's Apple Watch, Wi-Fi only model, tap, listen now, tap,
back to listen now one tab. Of four. So this is kind of where you'd start if you, started the app again.
iBUG Buzz, number look, 547, there it is. iBUG Buzz August 15, right there in 2022.
Your, in your listen now feature. So it's very easy to find there also. Or you could go back to library.
Tab bar, browse, tab, selected, listen now, browse, library.
Library.
Latest episodes, button.
Okay.
Recently updated, heading, iBUG Buzz, updated Wednesday.
There button. It is.
An illustration of a ladybug on a white surface, mini player.
So it's right there for double you as well.
To expand.
So, and of course, you can do the same thing for all the different iBUG podcasts because they're all separate. So you do have to subscribe to each one separately. And there are, I think, five to choose from. So hopefully this gives people a little more idea of how they can maybe easier access the iBUG podcasts. And if you have any questions,
all right, very good. Thank you, David. He had to pre-record that and he sent that to us. Unfortunately, David couldn't be here with us today, but we've got others that have used the Apple Podcast app here that can hopefully answer questions. So we are going to now open it up to anyone with questions about the about uploading the iBUG Buzz or any of the iBUG podcasts.
This is Dan.
Yeah, go ahead, Dan.
Okay, let's say that I listen to an iBUG Buzz podcast, and then I said to myself, "Okay, this is great. I've got everything I need. I don't want to have this taking up my storage anymore. I'd like to remove this." This one episode, is there some way to do that in the Apple Podcast app?
Yeah, go ahead, Sandhya.
Yeah, I think though, that would be under the settings. You can set it up to delete once you've listened, or you know, so you could go in and work with the settings. But yes, you should be able to do that. Yes.
Okay, I'll work with the settings. Thank you.
Yes, sir. And just a reminder, we don't use the hand raise feature, so you could just say your name and wait to be recognized.
Yeah, look like Impish, look like you're on the phone. You can just go ahead and unmute.
ask your question. Oop, went away. Okay, anybody else? Questions?
Allison Barnes.
Yeah, go ahead, Allison.
Does it cost to subscribe to this podcast?
No, it does not. It is absolutely free, just like the original meetings are. Everything we do is absolutely free.
Okay. And another thing I was going to check with y'all about, you know, on VoiceOver, how do you delete notifications?
How do you delete notifications?
Yes. So I haven't had enough assistance doing this.
This is Sheree.
Go ahead, Sheree.
Are you talking about the notification on the banner on the top of your screen?
You know, like messages and phone messages.
Correct. If you get a banner message notification, what you do is on that notification, just flick up or flick down and you'll get a dismiss button and double tap and it'll go away.
Okay, because I haven't had enough assistance using the iPhone.
Okay, very good. Thank you, Allison. And let's stick with questions about the app first. And then if we have any time left over, we'll go to general type questions. Any other questions on using the Apple Podcast app? Its features have come a long way. It's very similar to, you know, a lot of the more heavy hitting Downcast and Overcast and some of the others that people have been using for years. If there's no questions.
Well, this is Sandhya.
Sandhya.
Yeah, I was just going to, I mean, some people, you know, like David said in the podcast that you know, you can't always go to our website and listen to it directly. You can download it from the website, but then sometimes people say that it times out and, you know, whatever. So you can avoid all of those problems by just subscribing, and then you avoid all that drama. And then within that, David was showing you how to move forward in increments of 15 or 30 seconds, but there was also at the beginning a track position slider, so you can also move in bigger increments as well. So just wanted to, you know, maybe something is you're not interested in a certain point or whatever, you can go forward and then you can go to the next topic. But yeah, there we go.
All right. Yeah, we need to talk to David. He was talking about fast forwarding through our ads.
Never.
This is Mary Linda.
Yes, go ahead, Mary Linda.
I take it this app, since it's Apple, is free.
It is.
And so one major problem that I have had in trying to listen to some of the episodes or maybe even other things through YouTube is I don't subscribe to YouTube, so I have to put up with those ads. Is this ad free?
It sure is. Yeah, we don't run it. We're not supported by any kind of ads. The only time we do, if you want to call it an ad, we do announcements of our own upcoming meetings.
Self-promotion.
Well, no, that's not what I meant. You're not selling skin cream or anything.
No.
So to download the app, is there some particular language I need? Because I would like to do this.
This is Sheree.
Go ahead, Sheree.
Yeah, you can just ask. If it's not preloaded on your phone right now, you can just ask Siri to find Apple Podcast on the App Store.
Yeah.
And it'll find it for you. And then what you'll do is you'll swipe right. If it's not loaded, it'll say get. If it needs to do any kind of update, it'll say update. Otherwise, it'll say open. And if you open it by double tapping with one finger, it'll open the podcast app for you.
But if I'm hearing what you're saying, it could be preloaded on here and I don't know it.
This is Sri.
Yeah, go ahead.
That's why, you know, if you said, you could actually say Siri open podcast, and that if it's installed on your phone or on your device, it will automatically open that app for you. Just say open Apple Podcast.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Okay, and you can also search for it in the app library if Siri's not behaving well for you. It's located at the last home page, and you can just go to the search box and just type Apple Podcast.
Wonderful.
All right. Thank you, Sri. Any other questions?
This is Sharon. I have a general question. I'm new. This is my first time, and I can see Sri when he speaks. I saw the other lady when she spoke, but I didn't see any of the demonstration.
Yeah, normally everybody's camera's off. Some people choose to turn their camera on, but normally we don't have any cameras on during any of our demos. There's nothing visual. Since most of us are blind, we can't see anything anyway, and we're not showing anything on the screen.
Not intentionally.
Yeah, not intentionally.
This is Sri. That was my bad. I forgot to turn it off.
That's okay.
Sure.
Okay. Any other questions? Vincent, I see you unmuted. I don't know if you were planning to ask a question.
I got a question concerning the button. I know about the 10 seconds, you know, forward and backwards, but there are sometimes when I want to go back and going 10 seconds at a time, it just doesn't help. And I have a heck of a time finding, you know, how to use the selector to go back, let's say 5 minutes or 10 minutes when I want to, you know, go back and listen to a whole section. Is there some trick or something that I'm missing that I'm not doing?
Sandhya?
Go ahead, Sandhya.
Okay, I know that in most podcasts, you, within that settings, I know the devil's in the detail, but in those settings, you, I think, can set up like how much of an increment you want to move forward or backward. So that might be a help. But then, like I said, you can also use that position slider thing that I was talking about, and you can move quicker that way. I hope that's answering, but go ahead.
Yeah, no, it's just like, you know, I locate the slider, the position slider, but uh-huh. Then I try moving it like to the left, for example, or to the right, and it doesn't work.
You should slide up or down, actually. Did you try
that?
Oh, well, I'm glad I helped, I think.
This is Sri.
Yeah.
You know, once your focus is on that slider, then yeah, you do swipe up to move forward, swipe down to move backward.
That's why we're here, Vincent, to help each other. So go ahead.
Oh,
Sri,
that's why. I'm sorry. I couldn't find my phone before when that was one of the senior moment. Just to say that I am also going to be celebrating my birthday on the 27th.
Aw, happy birthday.
And as a sign of the times, thank you. And perhaps that's why I cannot find a lot of things. It's going to be my three quarters of a century birthday.
So. Oh, wow.
All right. Way to go.
Well, we'll be there for the party. So.
Yes.
I'm knocked out. Thank you.
All right. Let's see. Tree was waiting, I think, to say something.
Yeah, I was just going to say, whenever you're have a slider, like Sandhya said, you can flick up or down to move to the slider going backwards or forward, but you can also do a one finger double tap and hold and slide to the left or to the right to move in of smaller increments with the slider. And if the app is in, you know, built for that, that should work also.
Great.
Yay, very good.
This is Marie.
Marie.
Can I go back a little bit and say, when she was asking about the Apple Podcasts, normally when you set up a new phone, it is automatically installed on your phone, so it probably is already there. And the other question is, although the iBUG podcast have no ads, there are some podcasts, if you don't subscribe and pay for it, there will be ads.
Yes, there are other other that's well, it could be a function of the app itself, the podcast app, or it could be a function of the actual podcast. Some podcasts you have to pay for.
Right.
Yeah, very good. Okay.
I had a birthday this month. Does that count? And Vincent has no excuse because I turned 80.
All right, 80.
80.
Very good.
You are awesome. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, both of you. Yes, yes.
So this is Sandhya. I just wanted to remind people for some of these questions. I know we have some new callers on. So some of the basic questions that we were talking about at the end here, those would be perfect candidates for our Monday night iBUG Buzz. That's where we, you know, take any kind of questions in the beginning. The first 45 minutes are for the novice user. Or so that's a great place. So come, you're already, you know, just use the same Zoom conference line and come on Monday. It's from 7 to 9 Central Time, and we'd be glad to help you with various questions.
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. 2 hours of Q&A.
2 whole hours.
This is Sri.
Hang on, Sri. We're going to see if anybody else has a question before we get ready to close it down for the evening. All right. Go ahead, Sri.
I just want to make sure on our iBUG Today podcast, you guys, it does show the notes also on there, right? If you continue to swipe right on the podcast on the particular show, does it show your show notes?
No.
Or description of the show? Okay.
No, it's just a general description of what that podcast is about. Yeah, the notes are only available on the website. Yeah. And by the way, if you're not into podcasts, you can also find all of these on our YouTube channel. Go to, just search for iBUG Today on YouTube and you can find any of these.
This is Chris.
Okay, Chris.
Just real quick, since you're bringing up alternative sources, is it also available on the A-Lady and on Google HomePods too?
It is, but lately it's been hit and miss to get those to play. I've noticed some issues, and I don't know what that's a function of. You have to be very specific in the wording you use. It's generally play iBUG Cafe podcast,
mm-hmm.
or play iBUG Apple Workshop podcast. And generally it brings it up, but and sometimes it will not.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Jose, were you trying to ask a question?
Yes. I just want to brag about a purchase that I made recently. I treated myself to a new iPad. The one I had was centuries old. So I bought a iPad Air 5th generation. I'm on it right now. So far, I love it. I love the sound. It has speakers on both sides. So I just wanted to share that with the group.
Oh, that's awesome. Congratulations.
You sound good, too, Jose. You sound really good.
Even without the new iPad, I still sound good.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Of course, of course. You're so modest, too.
All right, we got one more minute. Let's see. Let's go. Let's go. Who else has a question? Any other questions before we close it down here? All right. Well, thanks everyone for joining us for iBUG Apple Workshop. We'll be back here in another month, 4th Saturday of September. I think it's the 24th. So join us again for that. And all of our other episodes you can always find on our website. Everything else is too. iBUGtoday.org. Let's go. Let's go.
Thank you, Sandhya and Michael.
All right. Thank you, everybody, for coming, and we'll see y'all next month. Thank you.
Yes, sir. All right.
Will you stop? Like a kid in a candy store. Okay, thank y'all for thank everybody you, for helping.
Thank you, Michael.
Bye.
Bye. See you Monday.